Brock Mauller, what's up, man?
Oh, not a lot. Just living every day.
Yeah. It's good to see you. It's good to see you. What's new? How's your family?
Oh, they're good. Both my parents are still working, and times are crazy right now. So it's good to have some normalcy. So.
Yeah. So they didn't have like any interruptions with their work or anything.
Oh, but my mom, she can take phone calls from her office, and my dad's still working and his job, so they're still doing good. So
that's cool, man. So you know, obviously, I know that you're year-round training, always yeah. trying to get better. How are you? How are you continuing to improve? And maybe what adjustments are you making when times are different? What are you doing?
I really don't want to change anything up, like just because this happened. I don't want to say, okay, I got to change what I do up and continue not to grow. So, I want to stay mentally sharp. So I'm thinking about wrestling like every day. Even if I can't get on the mat every day, I'll try and spend an hour just trying to think about positions and what I need to do to get better. So,
dang. So kind of try to take me through that process, like. But you're telling me you're able to improve just by thinking about wrestling, and so how do you make adjustments when you're just thinking about something and you're not actually on the mat doing it?
Sometimes if I'm having a hard time really getting into that mode, I'll pull up like maybe one of my matches or something like that, watch like the first couple, like I'd say first 30 seconds of it, and then I'll wrestle the rest of the match in my head. And maybe it won't look like the rest of the match that actually happened, but I'll see what that guy's doing and what I'm doing and what I could improve on. So I'll try and wrestle the match in my head, think about what I need to do, what I did do, what I forgot about, and then I'll go back and I'll watch the whole match, and then I'll see things that I missed or that I did remember. So.
So when you're doing that, you know, if you go over several matches, are there things that you can note, like, man, I've told myself four times now that I needed to make an adjustment here.
Yes. And that's when I'm like, okay, so I've told myself this. Now I need to. I've told myself this many times. Now this is the time I need to get on the mat and actually have someone put me in that position and actually do it. The muscle memory type thing.
Nice. You ever have you like reached out to anybody when you're finding these areas that are repeating to talk to them about it?
Oh, yeah. One coach, Maple, he's good at spotting those type of things, and we've grown a lot through this year. Just the first year, he's really done a lot to really improve my wrestling, just small things, and he's good at picking the right partners for me and really helped me adjust to the things that I need help on. So.
Cool. Well, I was going to ask you about him like later on in our talk, but let's do it. So, Kendrick Maple and Tyrel Todd, newer to the Mizzou staff, just 1 year in, right? One season in. What do they bring to the table? And you kind of told me what one area Kendrick's really good in already.
Yeah, I think they work really, really well with each other. I think they're friends in the room and friends out of the room, so it brings a good dynamic in the wrestling room. They compete with each other, but at the same time, I don't know. It's different. It just makes the wrestling room a lot more enjoyable, I think, when they work together.
Because they coached together in the past, right?
I believe so. I'm not sure where or when, but I believe they have.
Gotcha. And so. Do they run the practices more so than Brian Smith?
It really depends. I mean, they only got in. I want to say Todd got in at the end of the summer, and Maple a little bit after that. So like they weren't there a lot for, I want to say, summer training. So it was pretty much season. But yeah, they're really there for individuals, and they'll run through some practices for us.
Gotcha. All right. So, I wanted to, you know, talk to you a little bit about, you know, it's probably a tough year, and you were actually one of the guys when the NCAA, when they decided to cancel them, you were one of the guys I thought about, probably because, you know, I've been around you more, and I follow your wrestling, so, you know, tell me your reaction when you first found out that you weren't going to get to go get your national title.
I mean, it hurt. It hurt a lot, but, I mean, it's hard. I'm trying to think. I mean, I knew this wasn't going to be my only opportunity. Because, like, I mean, I thought about some of those seniors. Like, it was their last year, and it's, I mean, I don't know what I'd do if I was in their shoes. Like, that's tough. That's so tough. Like, so, I mean, I had to think about it, like, okay, yeah, this year's a bust, but, I mean, I have another 2 years, hopefully, you know. I'm pretty injury-free, and I don't know. It's hard. I don't know what to think about it.
What did Brian Smith say to you guys?
Well, once everything was canceling, I was like, okay, there's no way they're gonna cancel this tournament. Like, it's not a thing. Like, you know, that's never happened before. So, I didn't really believe it, you know, at first, or even come leading up to it. So we were I want to say it was Wednesday or Thursday the week before Nationals, and it was the afternoon. We were lifting weights, and we had a little bike workout before our weights, and we got done with the bike, and he came out of his office, and that's kind of when he broke it to us. So that was tough, especially for like Connor. He's a senior, man, and he never really got to finish his season or do what he needed to do. So I don't know, one of those things, man, can't control.
I wonder you know, it's tough. It's got to be tough for anybody that's working hard for something, whether it's wrestling or not. And obviously I say this, I'm a wrestler, but it just seems like in general to get to the top level of Division I wrestling and even just qualifying for that tournament, like you think about all those people, it's probably hard for many to understand how hard that kind of news would be.
Yeah.
Was it any consolation? You know, I saw that you got awarded that like NWCA like All American status.
Yeah. I was like, I mean, you can't really do that because anything can happen at the national tournament. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't want to sound cocky, but I knew that I was gonna be right there in the finals. I knew I was gonna do it, but I don't know. It's just hard for them just to give away All American status and kind of sweep it under the rug and say let's just go on to next year. So I don't know. It's tough. I don't know.
I was thinking that same thing. Like, let's say, you know, obviously each year there's those guys that you're like, man, it would have to be like one in a million for this guy not to do it. But you know, I never wrestled the NCAA tournament. You have, like even a guy that's ranked number 5 in the country. Man, yeah. you're gonna have to work and earn it. And there's, you know, one mistake here or there, and you're not gonna get it. So, and some people thrive at that tournament, and some people don't. So, what they do? Just give it to? Do they give it to top 8 guys, top 10 guys, something like that?
I don't know how they did it. I just saw that I saw it on social media, and I was like, okay, cool. That's nice. But I don't know who else they gave it to in my weight class. I don't know how they did that. I mean, it might have been a vote.
Sure. Yeah, man, it'd be tough, especially at 149 with just, yeah, you look at the top 15 guys, and it's amazing. It, you know, what's it like, you know, you're returning All-American, and you said you feel like you're going to be competing for a national title, but what's your mindset going into it, like an NCAA tournament, when the truth is there's this huge pack of guys going for these 8 spots and really for one.
Yep. I knew I mean, all I had to do was wrestle. I knew that even if I wasn't my best, if I wasn't like 100%, like 100% of me is just teching everyone, but if I wasn't at 100%, so I was at 70, I knew that I was going to, the big phrase for that was I was going to find a way. Mm-hmm. That's it. I knew I was gonna find a way to win these matches. So I visualized it, me in every match, and I knew that I was going to find a way to get these matches done.
So, yeah, I think at your level, and again, I just think, like you said, you know, if you're at 100% or you're at 70%, what are the variables that could drop you back to just being at 70%?
Yeah. I'd say, I've noticed the guys that don't open up and wrestle at this tournament, and it's hard. Like, you don't, like, there's guys, you don't want to open up, you don't want to make a mistake. Guys are afraid to make mistakes. So the guys that don't open up, that tournament is a grind. That's tough. It's going to be hard to pull those matches through. And I realized the more I open up, the easier it is for me. Mm-hmm. I mean, as long as I keep, all those basic things down, like tried and tough and all that, but the more I open up, the easier it is for me. So, and even if I do make a mistake, I know that I'm good enough that I can wrestle through any position, really. Like, I feel comfortable this year that, I don't know, I felt like no one's really given me, like, a, not a scare, but I haven't felt like anyone's can out-wrestle me, so.
Mm-hmm. Well, how about, you know, the one, you know, I'm sure it's something you don't like to think about, but you had one loss this year. I remember turning on the computer, and when Missouri wrestles, I always go see how you and Jarrett do, and it just caught me off guard. And even though you probably don't want to talk about it, I just always have been curious. You know what happened in that match?
I would say. Not that I didn't want that match. I don't know. I think I wasn't there. I didn't prepare 100% mentally and physically up to that match. So it was kind of like, I kind of just dropped the ball on that. I let the guy take me down twice in a row, and they're like, okay, this is a catch-up game. And this guy is good at hunkering down and not letting me score. So I want to say to drop the ball on it. And, yeah, it sucks, but that match didn't matter. Matches and nationals matter. So, I visualization all through the year of being in the finals and those matches. So, I mean, yeah, it sucks, but it also shows things I need to work on and make sure that sort of thing doesn't happen in nationals.
Yeah. So what did you take from that one? I mean, you mentioned the, you know, mentally and physically being prepared. Mm-hmm. Anything else that you took from that match that, you know, ultimately going to help you become a better wrestler?
Yeah. I'd say in that match, I think the first whole period, I was letting him get to his positions, like his underhooks and that sort of stuff. I was being a little too laid back, I want to say. A little more, I don't know. It's hard to explain, but I wasn't as eager to get to my positions, so it's kind of, is in his playbook, I want to say.
Yeah, so what was the difference in, you know, the Brock Mauller wrestling Jensen and then Brock Mauller, you know, taking out Boo Llewellyn?
Oh, Boo Llewellyn, I wasn't going to let him have anything. He was going to have to fight for every little thing he got. So that's just the mentality for that match leading up to the week. I was thinking about that match, and I was like, I'm not going to let him have anything. In that match, I didn't think about it too much. And that's kind of where I dropped the ball. But those big matches like that, I'm going to get to my positions. I'm going to score. So,
do you like the weeks leading up to those big matches?
I mean, sure. I don't like to make them a huge, great deal, but, I don't know, because I like to be consistent every week, so I don't want to be like, okay, this is a big match, I need to change everything up. So, but I mean, maybe I'll do the one little extra thing, like, I don't know, drink more water, this type of stuff, have a have my diet a little better leading up to those matches. But I'm pretty consistent, I want to say, every week to week, no matter who I'm wrestling. So
yeah. What about the 149-pound weight class, man? Again, you look through it, it's not only all these hammers. In, like, the top 10, it's just, what, Kolodzic and Lugo are the only ones that won't be there next year. So for me as a fan, I'm like, man, this is awesome. I mean, it's so many good years of 149. Is it the same attitude, just not, you know, not putting too much stock into it, or what?
What do you mean exactly?
Like, what's your feeling when you know, like, it's never going to be an easy year to win a weight class, but 149 is just one of those deepest ones. And, you know, even it, there's not that many juniors. We lose those two. There's not too many juniors in there. It's all freshmen and sophomore. They will be juniors next year.
Yeah. I never got to wrestle Lugo. I kind of wanted to wrestle him, you know, kind of put it on him, but I'm not going to have the mindset of, oh, it's going to be easier than it has been. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to leave a doubt. I'm not going to have a doubt of anything, so I'm going to go in there and prepare like I have every year, and I believe great things will happen.
Yeah.
Majors and stuff, so, yeah.
Who's your favorite guys to train with in the room?
I like to wrestle with, I want to wrestle with everyone. I want to have every feel. I want to learn everything I can. So, favorite guy. I like some of these freshmen that we've recruited. Precious. He's a guy. He's good from Texas. He's pretty crafty. He has own little feel. I like to wrestle him a little bit. And, I don't like just to wrestle the little guys, but another one that's going to really, I think, help me coming up the next year is Schmidt. Mm-hmm. He's a veteran, and he's pretty tough. I had a little individual with him, and when he shuts down, he's hard to score on. So he's one of those, he won't let you have anything. You got to fight for every little bit of everything, so.
You said you like wrestling with everybody. I had a lot of fun watching some videos of you and Michael Chandler wrestling.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
Man, he was, I don't know, there was this one time he was wrestling Jordan Lean at Cornell, and I was there, and they did like a 2-minute-long scramble. It was one of the coolest things I've ever seen. And then, you know, what's your take on Chandler? And, you know, he's got some man strength on you, probably.
Oh, yeah.
You know, he's getting older. But super scrappy wrestler, tough as nails in a fight. What did you take from wrestling Chandler?
Well, okay, not even okay wrestling, but after that video, I was like, damn, I'm that small compared to him. He's big. I'm like, I'm just a little kid looking at it. But we had a Zoom meeting with him, and he fights for everything, man. He doesn't care. He'll go to the brink of passing out exhaustion for when he wrestled on the team. He talked about how he would go for those majors and the technical falls because it helped the team. He thought about, he put the team before himself, and I think that really stuck with some of the freshmen and some of the guys on that call. And he just goes and he doesn't care, so it's hard to explain.
Yeah, you're right about it. He's big. I don't let my wife see Instagram videos that he puts up. Like, dang.
He posts a lot every day, but I mean, that's a good thing. You know, people need to see that what he's doing, man. He's not just sit around, go out there and work.
Yeah. So. Does Maple wrestle much in the room? I mean, he's an All-American at your weight class. His senior year is at 49.
Okay.
And wasn't All-American. Yeah. He was national champ at 41, and then senior year he All-American at 49. But does he wrestle? Does he wrestle much in there?
He does. He'll pick and choose his days, though.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Maybe when I'm a little tired, which I'm not tired much in the room, but I want to say he'll grab me if I'm having a. like a week where I don't have a lot of those weeks, but like I'm not opening up, I'm taking my shots, and it'll be like, okay, you need to score 10 takedowns on me, and we might go an hour and a half, but wow. He knows that in the long run it'll be good for me. He's like, you're gonna have to want this, so and I just went. So I want to say we drilled. I want to say 200 takedowns, and he would hand fight me, and I don't know. It was a different experience.
Yeah.
After one of those matches where I took maybe two or three shots, I only scored two of them. I'm like, I didn't open up. He's like, yeah, you need to get through this. So we went up to the room after and had our own little practice
after a match.
Yeah. Yeah, it was after a duel. So, but I needed it. I knew that it was good for me. So, I was exhausted after. But if he's willing to put in that time, you know, even after like a whole duel and just to help me out, I know he's gonna. It's good.
Okay. How do you like? What's the difference between you and like normal people? I mean, or an All-American. You know, you just made weight and you wrestled a duel. Now you're going to go do a harder workout than most people ever go through with Coach Maple. How do you get your head in the right place? You're like, all right, now am I going to go do this? I want to go do this. And and then make it effective for yourself.
Yeah. I don't know if I was mad at myself after the match. I mean, I won the match, but I don't know. I thought I was mad at myself after the match, or I was like thinking about maybe, I don't know what it was. Maybe I wasn't opening up. I was like, I didn't put in the work in this match, so I'm gonna go put in the work right now up in the room and get something out of today. And I definitely got something out of that practice. And I want to say the way I wrestle, I don't get tired very easily. So we were there for a while for me to really get tired with my shots and everything, and he was hand fighting me, and whenever I got lazy, he would just double leg me, and it was a mess. But it's something I needed, I think.
Yeah, that's cool. I remember wrestling you once. You were a sophomore at Tolton, oh my god! So James is like, James is like, Joe, this dude's tough. So those that are watching, my brother was lucky enough to coach Brock here for a while. Anyways, I didn't go to sleep that night. I stayed up all night. You know, I hadn't seen James in a long time, you know, and then went in and wrestled you for a while. Oh my gosh. It was torture. I remember afterwards, I had the worst headache for the rest of the day. And so, all right.
Either
this guy is amazing, or I'm just getting old, or I need to sleep. Oh, but, it was an eye opener. That was good, clean, fun. It was in that little tiny that room that you guys had. I remember walking in there and I couldn't believe it. It wasn't even big enough for you seven wrestlers.
Yeah, it was crazy. I don't know. I mean, the next year we had to go out to the gym and roll the mats out, but we were in that closet, man. It was, and I was thinking about it. It was like I can handle it because I've been wrestling forever. Like I know small spaces and not running anyone, but we had maybe like three or four, you know, new guys. I'm like, these guys are going to hit their heads on the wall. They're going to run into each other and it's going to be a mess, but somehow we figured it out.
Yeah. Yeah. Luckily, now they have two full mats out there. They got to roll them up, but gosh, it beats the heck out of that room. Let's talk real quick about, let's take it back, because I want to get back to high school, but, just tell me about like getting into wrestling. When did you start wrestling, and why did you start wrestling?
I started wrestling when I was like 4 or 5, and it was my parents knew I had to get into something because I was one of those kids who just had crazy energy, and I needed to channel it somehow. So I did wrestling, and I did football, and. Not that I didn't enjoy wrestling when I was a kid, but it was just wrestling such a tough sport. I don't know if I wasn't doing it right, but it was tough when I was a kid with wrestling. But I stuck to it, and I don't know. I think a big part was I had Mike Eierman there in my corner, and he saw something something in me that he knew was different. So he made sure and kind of steered me in the right path on this wrestling journey. So,
were you with Eierman from day one?
I started out, I started out with Eierman, and when he was in his little, he's at Rockridge, a little wrestling club, and then a couple of years later, he got his own room, and back then, he was all middle schoolers and like 10-year-olds, and I was like 4 or 5, so I didn't really have anyone to wrestle, but figured out a way somehow, but I went to the Columbia Club like a year or two, and it wasn't, it was just basically games and all that, but so I went back to Mike's when he got his room, and I've been there ever since.
Nice. I'm sure most people listening know Mike Eierman, but in your eyes, like, why is he a great coach? I'm guessing that you would say he's a great coach, so I guess I shouldn't assume.
Yeah.
But what makes him special?
It's almost hard to put into words, but he's given me the tools to grow in my wrestling and as a person, I'd say. He hasn't kind of like told me everything I need to do. He's given me the tools to grow my wrestling, visualize what I need to do. And he's just kind of been there. He's guided me, I would say, through high school a little bit. And he's kind of like, okay, you're kind of on your own. You need to figure this out a little bit. And I don't know, it's hard, but he's the reason why I'm still in wrestling, probably.
And he's out in the Northeast, right, at a training center?
Yeah.
Do you keep in touch with him? You talk to him much anymore?
Yeah, I talk to him. I try and talk to him when he's around. I mean, I think it's been a month or so since I've talked to him, so... But I think he's coming back here soon, so I'm hoping he comes back soon so I can get in the room with him and just talk and have one of those conversations. So
yeah, so you
situation.
Sorry.
So just talk about this whole situation because I'm sure he'll have a good opinion on it, and I don't know.
So even more than just coaching wrestling ideas and moves and stuff like that, he, outside of that, you just appreciate talking to him?
Yes, 100%. He I don't know, it's just as a person and just being good to family, and he's got a wrestling mind. He thinks about wrestling 24/7, so we'll have conversations and it'll be somehow related to wrestling, but you won't know. But he will know, and later on I'll think about that conversation that had to do with wrestling and I had no clue. So he's just got a wrestling mind. It's always going, and he's given me the tools to do that a little bit, because I'll think about wrestling almost every day, about with competing and practicing and everything. So
when was I guess the two moments we'll know about, maybe they're the same time, but when did you realize you're pretty good? And then the other one is when did you decide, hey, I'm going full tilt wrestling?
I'm gonna say my beginning of my freshman year in high school. I was still playing a little bit of football, and our high school team wasn't super, super good, and they wanted to push me up to varsity, and I was 120 pounds at the time, and I was like, I don't think this is the route for me, really. So, and I was like, I'm not going to get hurt, because I knew that I had something with wrestling. I loved wrestling, so I was like, if I love this sport, I'm not going to get hurt doing this other thing and not be able to do this sport. So I went 100% wrestling.
So what changed in terms of when you decided that it's all wrestling, and then you know you're good, and this is something that you want to do in the future? When you had that aha moment, what changed about your day to day life?
Well, I want to say from the beginning, Mike told us that we were going to be, or we will be, Olympic and national champions. And I mean, I was a kid, I was like, okay. And it kind of just flew over my head, but it was kind of like, I don't want to say brainwashed in a sense, but it was always instilled in us that that's what we're, that was our goal. That's what we were going to do. And that's where we were headed. So, when I kind of set those goals for myself, it was already there. It was already implanted and it was already seeded from Mike. Just remembering him telling me at 6 years old that you're going to be Olympic medalist and national champion. I was like, okay, we got to do it. So
nice. All right, give me a little bit of the, what's the James Williamson experience like?
James Williamson, he's his own character. He's fun. I think he's great for new wrestlers to really figure out the sport. And I don't know, he's done a lot for Tolton, I think. When I left, he had 3 or 4 in the finals, and he just did that pretty much by himself with the Mills, and he had Teague there to really guide him along. But he's good at figuring out things, you know, and doing what he needs to do with what he has, you know, because we don't have a big facility and backing by the school. So I think he's done a great job there.
Yeah, so it's interesting when I watch James coach, because like you're kind of alluding to, Tolton had these guys, you know, and the really high level, you and Jaydin, yeah. Eierman, Jared JQs, Teague Travis, yep. Now Brant Whitaker, he's yep. tough. And then there's some, you know, some gaps and then some really, really young guys. And I noticed yep. when he was coaching you guys, he was kind of quiet, you know, mm-hmm. he'd clap for you, yep. say, but and then, you know, he's really involved in the matches with the younger guys that don't understand wrestling like you. But how did he interact with, like, in the practice room with you compared to, you know, a guy like a young Montgomery Mills, you know, before he was winning?
I would say he would kind of split it up a little bit. Like, he would obviously let us go do what we needed to do, and he would watch and be like, if he saw something we did, he said, you need to go show that to Montgomery. But while we were doing that, he made sure and had Montgomery do pretty much the basics, you know, whatever that involved, just your shots, your top, bottom, basics. But then when he would come over and watch us and be like, Montgomery could really learn from this. So he would have us come over and guide him along on that move or whatever it would be. I think that's how he kind of did it. So
cool. He's a cool dude. All right, I just have a couple random questions and then some fan questions that people sent in. How about, you know, there's that moment, you know, Jaydin Eierman leaves to go to Iowa. You wrestled with Jaydin, you know, probably for years, right? So even before Tolton Catholic, before, I assume that you guys are close and, well, you're Missouri Tigers together. But what did you feel like when Jaydin made the decision to move to Iowa City?
I didn't have a problem with it. I mean, I talked with him. I was like, is this what you need for your wrestling? And he said yes, so I had no issues with it. That's what he wanted to do, and that's how what he felt like to make another jump. I have no issues with it. I'm not going to say, oh, you can't do that if he feels like he's not growing here. I'm not sure 100%, but I didn't have a problem with it. Yeah. It is what it is, and I feel like he is benefiting from it freestyle wise. So
nice. I'm just seeing way more and more transfers. It seems like the last couple of years it's just been transfer city. What do you feel? What do you feel about like all the guys transferring? Same thing as Eierman. Like, is your thoughts with Eierman?
Like who exactly transferring? Just like
everyone. In general that it's happening. you know, that the transfer portal just seems to be super active.
Yeah. I mean, I can't speak for other guys, but I think the way the program is set up at Mizzou, I know that I'll find a way and I can do it. I mean, it's a good, the way the program is run, it's good, and I know I'll find a way, but if Jaydin feels like he'll have better success in Iowa, I guess that's fine.
Yeah, but Mizzou does make national champions. It's exactly. Not a weird exactly. thing for a guy to be a national champion at Mizzou since Askren did it.
Yeah.
It's happened a ton of times since there another Askren and Ellis. You know, yeah. you could go down the last 10 years and find a good amount of them. But so Jaydin though, it was just more of a freestyle thing, a little bit bigger backing on a freestyle club.
Yeah, I'd say they have a backing freestyle wise. So I think he was kind of looking at it after college where he wants to land, and that's kind of what happened. So
gotcha. Let's see. Yeah. We probably answered a bunch of these, but let's pull up some fan questions here before we get going. Man, it looks nice wherever you are.
Yeah. Nice out there. My grants, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see here. Our questions are. Let's see, I have some up here. From Facebook, Casey Bryan. Ask him about his youth high school upcoming with Jaydin and Eierman Elite. We did that one. From Juliet Scher, St. Louis. What's one habit or skill developed in your youth career that you would identify as most responsible for your college dominance?
Ooh, that's a hard-worded one. So one like trade or one habit I learned as a kid.
Yeah, I'll read it again. I was like, what one habit or skill developed in his youth wrestling career would Brock identify as most responsible for his college dominance? So what's a number one thing that you feel like you developed as a youth wrestler that's contributed to your college success?
Obviously, I like to have fun, but yeah, I mean, finding fun in wrestling, it's a tough sport, and as I've grown into the college room, it can be a grind, but I have fun with it every day, I'd say. So finding a way to have fun, but being productive. Messing around, but having fun and being productive. And if you watch like Jaydin or Jaydin Cox, like, they'll have a smile on their face when they're wrestling, you know, and I like to think I'm the same way. So
you ever catch yourself in all this? One thing I think that the parts of my wrestling, when I wasn't getting better, I was on autopilot. I was hitting as many of my high crotches when I was drilling, but I wasn't, I wasn't focusing on parts of it that I need to get better. What, you ever catch yourself in autopilot? And if you do, like, what do you do to, hey, I'm not being productive, and snap back into it?
It's hard, because I'd say when I'm doing my moves, I'm thinking about how it would go in a match. So if you're just, you catch yourself just doing it and your mind's somewhere off, thinking about something else, you need to try and bring it back and focus on why you're doing this, why you're doing this setup, and two or three attempts, and focus on what the other guy's position is and all that. I think when I'm wrestling, my focus is so dialed in that it's hard to kind of wander off. You know?
Gotcha. From Steve Murphy, what advice would you give to young wrestlers in dealing with the grind of training and competing?
I mean, it's not always about winning. You gotta, I like to think about just the wrestling. Competing is almost kind of like a whole different thing. So I'd say in the room is having fun and growing in your wrestling. It'll happen when you compete. Even if it's not instantaneous, you're not winning these tournaments as a kid and all that, but just having a good mindset and just trying to grow in your wrestling, not always think about, oh, I got to win this tournament, I got to make this weight. And I feel like when you do that, it'll make it more enjoyable for you.
Cool. My man Rod Gaddy from Alabama. Who wins, you or James Williamson? What's the score?
As a kid, he had some weight on me. What is he?
Yeah. At the time, he was bigger when you were there. You should see him now. He looks really good now. Looked like a beast on him for a couple years.
We wrestled a little bit when I was a sophomore and a junior. He wouldn't wrestle me too much as a senior, but we wrestled around a little bit. It was fun.
So you're just saying you'd whip him now, huh?
I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah. Okay. From Sean Mail, at Mail Sean. Are you planning on finishing up in 4 years, or might you take a red shirt at some point?
I love to compete, so it just suck having to sit out a year. But I know that either way, I'll grow from the year. So it's kind of just up to what happens with all this mess, if there'll even be a tournament next year or something like that, or say our schedule's cut in half or we only have half a season, then I might. So I guess time will tell.
I'm not going to say the name of this one until after. What's the toughest dude you ever wrestled that's also named Brock?
I don't know.
Yeah, the question was from at Brock Zacherl.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
He's tough, dude. Tough dude.
Cool, man. Well, I really appreciate your time, Brock. I look forward to watching you wrestle more. I can't wait, dude. I've watched like every NCAA finals for the last, that's recorded right now, and I'm getting itchy. At least my son, since I do that, my son's like really getting into wrestling now. We wrestle all the time. But thank you so much. Anything else that you wanna say?
I think that's it. I mean, if you're a wrestler and caught in this, I mean, I'd say, even though they might tell you, don't do this, don't do that. I think as a wrestler, you're supposed to find a way, even if that's just running or doing something. Like me and my teammate Garrett, we were getting shut down everywhere we go. We were wanting to go do workouts and said we can't do that anymore. We can't go here. We can't go there. So we were like, okay, we gotta go. We gotta go wrestle on the grass. We're gonna find a way to get better and not just lay down. And just be like, okay, this is the way it is, and so do that.
All right, last thing, actually, give me the why should a young wrestler go to the University of Missouri to continue their wrestling career?
I'd say Mizzou, it not only helps you with your wrestling and that dream of being a national champion, because you gotta have that dream of being a national champion and really succeed at Mizzou. It helps you, I think, in life in general with Tiger style. Just all parts of your life. I've kind of figured that out a little bit. You gotta work on all parts of your life to really have it, the whole package, and put it all together. So, and I think we're kind of like a family too at Mizzou. So,
great. All right, Brock. Thanks so much. Like I said, we'll be watching you wrestle as soon as we can. But you take care. Tell the family hello.
I will.
All right. See you, Brock.
See ya.